ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us this edition of Leak Project. I'm your host, Rex Bear, and we have a roundhouse of power players with us tonight, folks. We have Mauro Biglino, a world-class translator of Hebrew and Latin, was handpicked by the Vatican to translate the Old Testament, and has had access to texts and scriptures forbidden to the public, author of several best-selling books, and at the cutting edge of his field. Also, Gerald Clark, best-selling author, and cutting edge in his field also, which is great because these guys come hand in hand. They parallel each other's work incredibly. It's like two peas in a pod here. And tonight's discussion is in regards to what Mr. Biglino discovered when working with the Vatican. He had access to materials tucked away into the vaults of the Vatican, and wait until you hear what Mr. Biglino says about the Old Testament, ancient aliens, genetic manipulation, cloning, archons, the Anunnaki, the Nephilim, the Watchers, Nibiru, its orbit cycle, slaves, torture, genocide, intergalactic sex, and more. Now, if you're a strong believer in the Old Testament and follow the more traditional, fundamentalist path of the Abrahamic religions or texts, this might not be the podcast for you, unless you're looking for an alternative history. Mr. Biglino also discusses how many rabbis and scholars in the know with access to some of these materials already knew what he discovered. Now, the way that he translated the Old Testament and several other works is he took the Hebrew text and directly translated it into the literal meaning. Gerald Clark's work, Anunnaki of Nibiru, Mercury Rising, also parallel the information Mauro has translated and put forth in several of his best-selling books. The main focus today is the book that will forever change your ideas about the Bible. Now, not only does Mauro claim the Old Testament was piggybacking off the Sumerian tablets, but also the Atrahasis, the Enuma Elish, the Epic of Gilgamesh. After the discussion, we noticed Gerald's audio didn't sound the same as it did during the presentation. This has happened to him before on other programs, not just with Leak Project. Could it be because his Skype line was targeted? Claudia's audio was good. Mauro's audio sounded fine. Mine worked okay. Gerald's was the only one that didn't sound right. During the presentation, it sounded just fine. And then when I went back to listen to the recording, whammo! Now make sure to go to leakproject.com for access to over 200 full-length podcasts updated daily on a wide variety of topics. If you use the code LEAKPROJECT at checkout, if you go to GeraldClark77.com, you'll get a 10% discount on any and all products Gerald has to offer. Mercury Rising, Anunnaki of Nibiru, the genealogy tablet scrolls. You can get them in e-form or good old-fashioned book. And they've also got a bounty of elixirs and tinctures and monatomic gold gourmet goodness at GeraldClark77.com. If you'd like to pick up one of Mauro's books, go to MauroBiglino.com.
C'è Rex e anche Gerald in linea. Also Rex and Gerald are online. E grazie per questa partecipazione. Thanks for participating.
Grazie a voi.
He's thanking us.
Oh, this is a real honor to speak with you.
Mucho gusto, mi amigo.
Grazie, grazie molte. The honor is mine. The honor is mine.
Oh, I don't know. I think we're on the same path, buddy, and it's pretty amazing. So, one of our fans from Italy told me that I should contact you because you and I had two very important pieces that need to be brought together. Did you have a chance to look over the questions, Mauro, and were they fair? Were they balanced? Are you okay with them?
Sta chiedendo se hai avuto occasione di leggere le domande per l'intervista.
Allora, io le ho ricevute, ma non le ho lette, perché non mi piace sapere prima che domande mi vengono fatte.
Fantastico, adesso traduco. He said yes, he has received the questions, but he hasn't read them because he doesn't like to know beforehand the questions that will be asked.
Well, that's mi annoio. Se that's conosco prima le domande, mi annoio.
Oh, he says if he knows the questions beforehand, he gets bored.
I like your style. So the first question that I would like to know is, why did the Vatican pick you to translate books in the Bible?
Allora, la prima domanda è di Rex e perché vorrebbe sapere perché, come mai lei è stato selezionato dal Vaticano per questo lavoro. Per questa traduzione.
Io sono stato selezionato dalle edizioni San Paolo, che sono la più importante casa editrice cattolica italiana.
Sì.
Non so se vuoi tradurre e poi io vado avanti.
Sì, grazie. He was chosen to translate from this
St. Paul Publishing.
Publishing, yeah, a very important publishing company called San Paolo. It's the most important Catholic publishing house or company.
In Italy. Also in Europe, I think. Perché io ho traducevo per conto mio e loro sono venuti a conoscenza delle mie traduzioni, le hanno verificate e hanno detto che io traducevo come loro e quindi mi hanno preso come traduttore.
Okay, so he says they contacted him because they realized that he was translating. He was translating before they contacted him, and then he was contacted because the Vatican explained that apparently it seems that he was translating exactly the way they would have wished to or were looking for. Va bene così, Mauro?
Sì, sì, sì.
Grazie.
So it's... Grazie. Go ahead.
No, we were just thanking each other for helping each other out in English and Italian.
Awesome. Now, so obviously they found you because of your credentials. So did you study cuneiform, Sumerian, Hebrew? How did they discover you, essentially?
Allora chiede, ovviamente lei è stato scoperto in quanto l'assunzione è stata fatta in quanto la sua conoscenza delle tavolette sumere con i formi e qual è stata la motivazione basilare, diciamo.
Allora, io sono stato scelto perché traducevo l'ebraico della Bibbia dei Masoreti.
Okay, he was chosen because he was translating the Masorite Bible, the Hebrew Masorite Bible.
Okay.
Hey Rex.
E poi hanno verificato che io conoscessi anche il greco antico e il latino, perché altrimenti non ti prendono come traduttore.
Okay, so then they also had to took him because they had to verify and knew that he also knows ancient Greek and Latin, because otherwise they won't accept you as a translator. You won't be taken for the job. Those are prerequisites.
Okay, and Gerald, okay. Did you want to say something?
Well, I wanted to ask Mauro why what his standing, his relationship with the Vatican was up to the point where he was terminated in 2010, and why they were focused on the Masoretic text over all the other translations. Why was the Vatican interested in this particular Masoretic text versus others?
Mauro, come mai il Vaticano si interessava a questo testo masoretico anziché altri possibili testi? Come mai questa scelta?
Perché è il testo principale da cui derivano in sostanza le Bibbie che poi vengono tradotte e che tutti abbiamo. È il testo della tradizione principale.
Okay, it's the traditional text that is used, the principal one, to then be brought into the Bibles that most of the people read. This is for the Italian. E questo è pertinente all'Italia o in generale?
Vale un po' per tutti. Poi okay. Però adesso si stanno usando anche altri testi. Cioè si sta usando la Bibbia scritta in greco, si sta usando i testi di Qumran che sono più antichi di quelli dei Masoreti.
Okay, this is in general, yes, and they are starting now also to use other texts like the Qumran and also aveva detto greco, se non
greco,
mi sbaglio.
Sì, sì, sì.
Yeah,
sì.
And also the Greek one. So
okay, well, I wanted to follow up with Mauro. At what point were you aware of the Sumerian story when you started connecting it with what you discovered in the Masoretic text? Had you read the Sumerian stuff prior to decoding the Masoretic text?
E chiede a quale punto ha preso, diciamo, nota dei documenti sumeri. Era a conoscenza di questi documenti prima del contratto col Vaticano?
Ma allora, bisogna sapere che tutti i racconti delle origini della Bibbia sono copie dei testi sumeri.
Okay, we have to realize that all the copies of the Bible. Puoi ripetere l'ultima frase per cortesia?
No, tutti i racconti delle origini della Bibbia sono una copia dei testi sumeri.
Okay, so they are a copy of the Sumerian texts. So that is how.
Sono copie della epopea di Gilgamesh.
Mm-hmm. They are copies of the Gilgamesh epic.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I'm
seeing it. Atrasis.
Sì, sì.
E della Enuma Elish.
Sì, tres documentos es mi mejor. Atrasis, Enuma Elish, epic Gilgamesh, mismo. This is the absolute seminal point of this entire dialogue. Mauro was aware that all the biblical texts, the Hebrew ones, no matter what they were, came from the Sumerians because they predated them by thousands of years. He knows that, and I know that. The problem is, how do you validate that the Sumerians' texts are not myth and that the Bible is telling the truth? And what we find is the Bible is not telling the truth because it borrowed from the Sumerian text. And so this is the key point. So at what point did he and the Vatican realized, and did they go into this decoding knowing that knowledge? Were he and the Vatican, I'll just put it in one simple question, were Mauro and the Vatican both operating under the assumption that all Hebrew texts were derived from the Sumerian text, or was that just Mauro alone?
Allora Mauro, non so se ha seguito, comunque l'ultima parte richiede se lei e il Vaticano erano a conoscenza della base dei testi sumeri e poi alla fine ha chiesto come si fa a connettere il mito, a farlo diventare reale quando la Bibbia non racconta la storia effettivamente com'è, da quello che ho capito. Però se vuole allora, possiamo ripassare questo punto.
Allora, provo a rispondere semplicemente.
Grazie.
Tutti gli studiosi, tutti gli studiosi, compresi i rabbini, sanno che la Bibbia non è un racconto originale, ma è una copia.
Okay, all the rabbis know that the Bible is not an original copy, but a story, but it's a copied story.
Mm. Quando si parla di testi antichi, che sia o di lingue antiche, che questa sia l'ebraico o che questa siano le lingue sumero-accadiche, non bisogna sapere che non si possono mai avere certezze assolute.
Okay, so he says whether it is the ancient archaic
language.
Sorry?
Ancient languages as Hebrew or Sumerian.
Okay.
Source, because the può ripetere l'ultima frase
allora,
della Bibbia?
Con le lingue antiche non si possono mai avere certezze assolute. Bisogna sempre essere disposti ad avere il dubbio.
And hence, you can't have an absolute certainty. You always have to remain with an open mind, with a moment of doubt. A pinch of salt.
That's right.
Take it.
Okay. Well, what I wanted to say was, as a result of what he just said, the people of the Vatican and Mauro already knew prior to decoding the Masoretic text that they were derived from the Sumerian source.
So, quindi il Vaticano e lei già sapevate che era derivato da una sorgente dei testi sumeri?
Sì, che le parti iniziali della Bibbia derivino dai testi sumeri lo si sa da tanto tempo.
Yes, this is known since quite a while.
Però questo non viene detto alla gente, cioè ai fedeli non viene detto che la Bibbia è una copia dei testi sumeri, ai fedeli viene detto che la Bibbia è ispirata da Dio.
Okay, he says, but to the followers, to the proselytes, the Christian, the people with Christian faith, that they do not tell this about the Bible. They say that the Bible was written by God, although they do know that it was written by the, or taken from the Sumerian texts.
This is, I wanted to follow up on that. That is such a profound statement, because I grew up in a region of America in the Midwest where the masses of the population are still being taught what Claudia just said, that that book is the absolute truth, it's irrefutable, and it's the word of God, and they're willing to kill and defend their faith over that. This has been going on for a long time.
Well, Mauro explained to me that in most cases, the church, he was saying, the church explains that this is the Bible is a creation of God rather than a copy of a more ancient text.
Yeah. Now, I've read through the Nag Hammadi treaties, which is some ancient texts that were found in Nag Hammadi, Egypt, in the 40s. And they have many of the same books that are in the Abrahamic Holy Bible, but they have different spins, etc. So my question is, has he read the Nag Hammadi treaties, and has he translated those texts also?
Mauro, allora chiede a quanto riguarda i testi del Nag Hammadi, se lei li ha letti, perché trova che c'è una correlazione anche lì.
Sì, ho letto quei testi, però quelli di Nag Hammadi sono testi che sono stati scritti soprattutto in relazione alla figura di Gesù.
He said yes, he has read the text of the Nag Hammadi, but they're used for the story of Jesus.
E sono in gran parte ispirati dal pensiero greco ellenistico.
And they're for the most part inspired by the Greco-Hellenic thought.
Thoth?
Or thought.
Okay.
Ideal.
Okay. Is he familiar with the Archons, and are they connected to the Anunnaki?
Lei ha familiarità con, non so se si dice in italiano, gli Arcioni?
Anunnaki.
Gli Anunnaki. Anunnaki. Sì. Lei
Anunnaki
è familiare?
È il nome sumero accadico degli Elohim biblici.
Okay, Anunnaki is the name, Sumerian name, of the, può ripetere l'ultima frase per cortesia?
Dei biblici Elohim.
Of the biblical Elohim.
I agree, by the way.
Gerald interviene dicendo che è d'accordo con lei. Lei ha mai scritto qualcosa sul Nag Hammadi? Ha pubblicato?
No, io ho pubblicato 7 libri, tutti sull'Antico Testamento.
Ok, he has not written, Mauro has not written anything on the Nag Hammadi, but he has written 7 books on the Old Testament.
You know, the one book that's called the book that will forever change your ideas about the Bible, I mean, that is just an absolute blockbuster. It will change many paradigms. If you don't want your paradigm shattered, I would not recommend reading that book.
Okay, 1 second, let me kindly translate. Mauro sta dicendo che il libro che lei ha scritto, non so il titolo in italiano, immagino. Okay.
Ma è la traduzione dell'inglese, quindi...
Esatto, quindi... Sì. È un libro che cambia parametri o paradigmi all'intera storia, e che se uno non ha voglia di essere scosso, è meglio che non legga il libro.
Sì, io poi sono andato avanti e ho condotto degli studi paralleli tra la Bibbia e dei testi greci. Traduci, poi okay. Vado avanti a raccontare.
He said he's also went ahead and started translating the Bible, I think comparing with some Greek texts.
I testi di Omero, Iliade e Odissea.
The texts of the Iliad and Odyssey.
E raccontano esattamente le stesse storie, cioè gli dei greci sono gli Anunnaki dei Sumeri.
Okay, and he has found in that story that the Greek gods are the gods of the same gods of the Sumerian.
Questi libri io li sto pubblicando con la più grande casa editrice italiana, che è Mondadori.
Okay, and these books are going to be published. He is publishing these books with the biggest editorial company, which is Mondadori. It's the top notch in Italy.
Mm. Hey, Rex, I have another question for Mauro, if that's okay.
Cool.
I know that Mauro, in his book that you just mentioned, on page 24 and 25, he does the Adam and Eve, the Genesis account, and he does the flood story. In that account, he clearly points out the roles of Enki and Enlil. I was wondering if he would possibly tell the short story of our genetic creation account in the Garden of Eden and name the characters involved.
Let me just translate. Mauro, non so se ha seguito, dice nel suo libro, nel suo libro, a pagina 24-25, lei parla della creazione di noi da parte dei Anunnaki. Did you say the creation of us?
Sì.
Us by the Anunnaki, right?
Especialmente in La Jardin. In la ciudad Eridu.
Specialmente nella città di Uridu e Arin, is that garden?
Yes, the Garden of Eden, comparing and contrasting the two entities, that were there primarily.
Il giardino di Eden e la città di Urudi.
Uridu,
sì, scusi.
La domanda?
Could you repeat the question about on page 24, 25, he describes the creation of mankind?
Well, he actually describes the creation and the Genesis account in Eridu, and he compares Enki and Enlil and their roles. That's what I want him to come out and talk about. Who were those beings in the garden, and how do they tie to the Anunnaki?
Allora vuole che lei vorrebbe che lei ci spiegasse della, nel suo libro pagina 24-25 della creazione dei Genesis.
I would like him
allora,
to.
Allora diciamo così.
Those personas mejor, Enki and Enlil, en la jardín.
Allora, le due persone, Enki e Enel, nel giardino di Eden.
Ok. Allora, la Bibbia ci racconta esattamente questo fatto. Cioè, la Bibbia ci racconta che Adamo ed Eva sono stati fatti con l'ingegneria genetica. In particolare, okay. Eva è stata fatta con la clonazione.
Okay, he says that in this part, Adam and Eve have been made genetically, and in particular, Eve has been made through clonation or through being cloned.
Molti rabbini dicono questa cosa in assoluta tranquillità.
Many rabbis say this in absolute tranquillity, openly.
E nel giardino dell'Eden c'era il contrasto tra due rivali.
And in the Garden of Eden there was a contrast between two rivals. Mm-hmm.
C'erano quelli che avevano fatto Adamo ed Eva e che li volevano tenere sotto controllo.
There were those who did who created Adam and Eve and wanted to keep them under control.
E c'erano degli altri Elohim che invece hanno voluto dare ad Adamo ed Eva una maggiore libertà.
And there were other Elohims that wanted to give to Adam and Eve more freedom.
Agreed.
Questo ha portato all'allontanamento di Adamo ed Eva dal giardino dell'Eden.
So this brought hence the sending away of Adam and Eve from the Garden of Eden.
Io sto lavorando adesso e lo sto pubblicando nei libri con dei genetisti, dei biologi. Prego.
He is now working and he's going to publish it in the book. He's at present working with genetists and biologists
che stanno dicendo che queste ipotesi possono assolutamente essere vere e spiegano in che modo gli Elohim possono avere operato. E questi sono scienziati delle università.
So these scientists which come from universities are saying that it's absolutely possible that this has happened.
Yes, I'd like him to go ahead and name the names of the Anunnaki. He did it in his book. And how and what their positions were with the Anunnaki Council.
Potrebbe nominare gli Anunnaki e che posizione avevano nel consiglio?
Allora diciamo che il contrasto potrebbe essere avvenuto tra Enlil, che può essere considerato il comandante del giardino dell'Eden.
So the contrast could have been between Enlil, which was the commander of the garden,
e suo fratello Enki,
and his brother Enki,
che era il suo rivale per il potere,
which was his rival for power, which is actually
nella Bibbia il contrasto è rappresentato tra l'Elohim che comandava nel giardino dell'Eden e il serpente.
Okay, and in the Bible this contrast is presented as the Elohim that was in charge of the garden and the serpent, the snake.
E questo Elohim rivale, da quel che si legge dalla Bibbia, potrebbe essere il padre vero di Caino.
And this Elohim, this rival Elohim, we can read in the Bible, could be the father of Cain.
Agreed. So I just wanted to say that his story matches my story. I don't know if Mauro has read my book, The Anunnaki of Nibiru, but the story that you tell on page 24 of your book, that was mentioned here in English, matches the story that I tell with Enki and Enlil in the Garden of Riddu and exactly what happened, just as he tells.
Thank you. Allora, Gerald dice che è interessato a questo in quanto, non so se lei ha avuto occasione di leggere il libro di Gerald.
No, purtroppo.
Unfortunately, he hasn't had a chance.
Se me lo dice, poi lo prendo e lo leggo.
He said he will.
Mi manda il titolo scritto. Io lo prendo e lo leggo.
Okay. He will buy your book and read it.
Lo compro su Amazon. Mi scriva il titolo adesso qui.
No, è necessario per comprare il mio libro. È gratis.
No, ma per me è necessario.
È gratis. No, è gratis.
For me, it's interesting for me.
But what I wanted to bring up that's so controversial right now is I think Mauro and I both know there are other names for these beings. In particular, let's just focus on the two brothers. Enki was known as Poseidon. Enlil was known as Zeus. But Enlil was also known as Yahweh and several other names. So the idea that the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob could possibly be Enlil Yahweh, I want him to talk about that if he can. Would he comment on the also known as name Yahweh for Enlil?
Potrebbe commentare su anche l'altro nome di Enel come Yahweh?
Dunque, io leggendo la Bibbia, a me pare di capire che Yahweh potesse essere il figlio giovane di uno dei capi.
Mm-hmm. Okay, for him, it could have been that Yahweh could have been the son, the young son of one of the commanders.
E che gli hanno dato un incarico, quello di occuparsi della famiglia di Giacobbe.
And they charged him or invested him with taking care of the family of Giacobbe, for Jacob.
Per vedere che cosa sapeva fare.
To know what he was capable of doing.
E perché lui potesse diventare grande e importante.
So that he could, you know, become bigger and more important.
Mm-hmm. Nel libro, nel capitolo 32 del Deuteronomio,
in chapter 32 of the Poripetere,
Deuteronomy.
Yeah, oh, Deuteronomy, okay. Deuteronomy. Yes, of course.
Okay. Thanks for the help.
Okay. Nel capitolo 32 c'è proprio scritto
32.
Che a lui viene data solo la famiglia di Giacobbe.
It's specifically written in chapter 32 that he is only given the family of Jacob.
E che lui per occuparsene non si fa aiutare da nessun altro Elohim.
And he is in charge and to take care of this family. He doesn't get help from any other Elohim.
Questo è scritto chiarissimo.
This is written in very clear terms.
Okay, well, I wanted to say, as a follow-up, I did a God table. It's table number 9 in my book, where I've done also known as names and a genealogy table of all these characters. And I would like to spend more time corroborating exactly those names with Mauro, because I think it's important. Very important.
Allora, Mauro, lui ha una, Gerald ha creato, costruito una tabella. Is it a genealogical?
La genealogia degli Anunnaki, sì.
Esatto, sì. Esatto. Sì. gli farebbe enormemente piacere poter continuare una discussione con lei a questo proposito, perché c'è
allora io compro il libro, mm-hmm. me lo leggo e poi
después
Gerald,
perché la Bibbia purtroppo ci parla in sostanza soltanto di uno.
The Bible in substantially just speaks about one. And può ripetere per cortesia?
Yahweh speaks about only of Yahweh.
Exactamente. Allora,
perché
exactamente.
Quel popolo è interessato a raccontare solo la storia del suo rapporto con Yahweh e basta.
Because these people are interested only in explaining their history with Yahweh.
Exactamente.
E quel popolo è interessato soltanto alla realizzazione delle promesse che Yahweh ha fatto per loro.
And they're only interested at the outcome or the happening of the promises that Yahweh did to them. Only of that.
Correct. Well, I was going to pose a question, and you don't have to translate this, and this is kind of just for the English-speaking audience for a moment. I was going to pose to Mauro the question, did he see a theme through the entire Bible, especially the Old Testament, where Yahweh and Lul had editorial oversight? Well, he just answered the question for me. And I saw that, and he saw that. That's why I thought it was so important for people to understand that these Hebrew priests that were held captive in Babylon approximately 330 BCE, when they saw these Sumerian texts, they wrote their account in order to placate their god, Enlil. So this totally coincides with what Mauro has said.
Mauro, è riuscito a seguire?
No, è meglio che traduci, perché è molto lunga.
Just tell him that we see the Enlil's editorial oversight through the whole Bible.
Gerald ha fatto il commento per il pubblico inglese e dice che è della stessa opinione, sia lui che lei vedono allo stesso modo questa storia. I'd like to just add one thing. Mauro explained that once he's read your book, he will be more than happy to reconnect and be able to talk about it with Gerald.
In autunno, negli Stati Uniti, non so se a Washington o a Chicago, viene presentata la mia operazione per gli Stati Uniti, che è seguita poi da un importante agente letterario di Londra.
A very important literary agent will be following his introduction to the American market, and he's not sure yet in autumn if it will be in, ha detto, Washington oppure
o Chicago.
Either in Washington or in Chicago.
And the next year I will be in USA.
If you're willing to go to the USA, Mauro, I'll meet you there.
He will be. He will be next year in the USA.
All right, Gerald, you're coming out, man. Bingo!
We can meet each other. Possiamo incontrarci.
Assolutamente. I gotta ask some questions if I can.
Questo è un gioco, però succede così. Il prossimo anno esce a Hollywood un film che si intitola Creators.
Okay, next year in Hollywood, it's a film is going to come out of production, which is called Creators.
Oh, really?
Gérard Depardieu.
Yeah, with the French actor Gérard Depardieu.
William Shatner.
Wow.
And William.
Bruce Payne. E io ci sono e faccio Mauro Biglino.
Oh, and he is also in the film. And
really? Congratulations. Congratulations.
It's only a little.
So,
That will be wonderful.
Hey, I see Mauro Biglino che viene intervistato da una TV americana.
So the role he will play is of himself, Mauro Biglino, while he's being interviewed by an American television.
Just like now. Rex, are you with us here?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm right here.
I really don't want to ask him any more difficult questions. I got lots of them. But I think until we get more on the same page, even though I realize he's completely on the same page with me, what do you have other questions for him? What I know you had some.
Yeah,
I do have some questions, and these are a little bit different, but I think that it's important because with all the information that is coming to the table now about the Anunnaki, the translations of the Sumerian tablets, and the very real possibility that ETs influenced our physical vessels. What I want to know is, what were we before this manipulation? And I've got more questions than that, but that's the most important one right now.
Okay, Mauro, Gerald diceva che lui è contento di tutte le domande e poi dopo potrete in futuro ricollegarvi. Poi Rex ha detto con tutta la certezza o la realtà di questa influenza dei Anunnaki nel creare il nostro vessillo fisico, diciamo, vascello fisico. Che cosa eravamo prima, si domanda.
Prima eravamo Homo habilis e Homo erectus.
Okay, before we were Homo habilis and Homo erectus.
E il processo che ha portato dal progenitore comune con le scimmie.
So and the process that brought forward the communal root from the mi può finire l'ultima frase?
Scimmie, dalle scimmie.
Yeah,
comune,
so
radice con le scimmie.
Basically, yes, the common root from monkeys.
È un processo che ha portato alla unione di due cromosomi, cromosoma 2 e cromosoma 3, che sono stati fusi.
Okay, so it's a process where two chromosomes, chromosome 2 and chromosome 3, have been fused.
Mm-hmm. I'm aware of that.
Si chiama traslocazione robertsoniana.
So it's called in Italian, and I'm going to make a very direct literal translation, the transformation, può ripetere la parola?
Robertsonian.
Robertsonian.
Robertsonian translocation.
Translocation.
Che ha fatto sì che da 48 cromosomi si è passati a 46.
So from 48 chromosomes to go down to 46 chromosome, and that
exactly
identifica.
Sì, sì. I'm in agreement.
Poi hanno fatto altri interventi.
Afterwards, prego. They did other subsequently they did other interventions.
Per lo sviluppo specifico del cervello.
For the specific development of the brain.
E sono tutti interventi che devono essere fatti con la clonazione sotto controllo.
And they were all interventions that had to be done with cloning being under control.
Perché sono molto pericolosi e possono portare alla morte.
Because it's a very dangerous method and it can bring to about death.
Perché in natura spontaneamente non avvengono.
Because in nature they don't happen spontaneously. So è un'aberrazione in pratica.
Esatto, e la stessa cosa è stata fatta nell'Eden in Mesopotamia.
The same has been done in the Eden in Mesopotamia.
Sui cereali.
on the cereals.
Organo.
Grain.
Che è stato prodotto attraverso interventi genetici che in natura non possono avvenire.
Which were these grains and wheats were done in a way that in nature cannot come about, cannot happen.
Così scrivono i genetisti sulle riviste scientifiche.
And this is how the genetists actually write on scientific publications.
Mm-hmm. E con questi cereali hanno nutrito milioni di lavoratori, cioè noi.
Okay, and with these cereals they created, they've nurtured millions of workers. In other words,
hanno nutrito,
us.
Nutrito, e in
they
America,
nurtured. And in America,
hanno fatto la stessa cosa con la patata.
Okay, in America they did exactly the same thing with the potato.
Che ha inglobato il DNA dell'agribacterium.
Which has encased, taken within the bacteria of
Agribacterium.
Agribacterium.
Okay? Mm. Che è quello che la rende commestibile.
Which is what makes it edible.
E questo in natura non avviene.
And this doesn't happen in nature.
Quindi questi hanno fatto noi e poi hanno fatto gli alimenti per nutrire questi lavoratori che aumentavano sempre di più di numero.
Okay, therefore they created us and these workers and also their food samples, their food, the basic mm-hmm. food stuff, because of the multiplication of these workers. It was continuously, the population was expanding.
E noi ci stiamo moltiplicando moltissimo.
And we are multiplying further, a lot more.
Perché non siamo più un prodotto dell'evoluzione naturale.
Because we're not anymore a product of the natural evolution.
E la natura non ha potuto creare i nostri competitori che potevano limitare il nostro numero.
And nature was not able to create our competitors to enable a limit to our growth, to the numbers we have.
I have one final question, Rex, unless you want to ask it. Did you see what I typed there on the line? I'd really like to know Mauro's opinion on the influence of the Anunnaki today in the headlines. Does he see influence of the Anunnaki today in the New World Order and what's going on? In other words, does he believe the Anunnaki are still involved today?
Sta chiedendo Mauro, Gerald le sta chiedendo se lei pensa che ancora oggi gli Anunnaki hanno un'influenza sul nuovo ordine mondiale e su quello che sta succedendo in questo momento.
Io penso che se domani scopriamo che loro sono qui e governano tutto, io non mi stupisco.
He said that if tomorrow he finds out or reads that they are still here and they are controlling, governing everything, he wouldn't be surprised.
That's a good answer. Well, I don't really have any more questions.
Anche perché, scusa, finisco, il sistema finanziario che ci governa.
Mauro is adding also because the financial system that's governing us, that's controlling us,
è descritto nella Bibbia.
Is described in the Bible.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And so
we're in complete agreement. And actually, I wanted to tell him, in my book, I describe who the characters are as part of the New World Order, and what their roles are relative to the zodiacal houses. I wonder if you had seen that, or was aware of that. The relationship of the Anunnaki and their rulership tied to the zodiacal house.
Like the Age of Aquarius right now. The Age of Aquarius, according to the occult and ancient writings, is when people start to wake up, become more aware, and break free from the chains from the previous house in the zodiac.
Mauro è riuscito a seguire un po'?
Poco, perché...
Dunque, Gerald ha connesso il potere degli Anunnaki con il modo di governare odierno e anche l'ha collegato con la carta zodiacale, se si può dire, con, in quanto poi Rex ha aggiunto stiamo entrando nell'era dell'acquario.
Sì, può darsi benissimo che loro abbiano il cambio di comando con il cambio della precessione degli equinozi.
So Mauro says that it could well be that they have a change of command when there's the happening of the change of the precession.
Equinoccio.
Equinoccio. Yeah, equinox. Yeah. Sorry.
Equinox. Yes. Okay. Al cambio di un'era c'è un cambio di comando.
Sì.
At every change of an era there's a change of command.
Lo storico romano Tacito
Tacit, the Roman historic figure.
Il più importante dei romani, scrive
The most
che all'epoca di Cristo.
Allora, ci siamo un po' accavallati. Sì.
Accavallati. Allora racconto tutto. Tacito dice che al tempo di Gesù Cristo, nei cieli di Gerusalemme.
Prego. Ok, Tacit, the most important historian of the Romans, says that in the skies of Jerusalem.
C'erano dei carri celesti e si udì una voce che diceva: le divinità lasciano questo luogo.
There were in the skies chariots, special chariots, and there was a voice saying that the divinities were leaving this place.
And so, al tempo di Cristo c'è stato un cambio di era.
Mm-hmm. So therefore, during the time of Christ, there was a change of era, like you were explaining earlier with the zodiac equinox or precession.
E quindi forse and quelli che comandavano lì se ne sono dovuti andare.
Hence, it could have been that those who at the time were in command there had to leave.
In the Old Testament, there's some passages that essentially Yahweh tells his chosen people, I think he tells Abraham, to go kill every man, woman, child, and all the livestock of certain communities. What are his translations on that?
Nella Bibbia c'è un passaggio dove Yahweh dice di andare a uccidere tutti gli abitanti, uomini, donne, bambini e anche gli animali domestici che avevano. Qual è il suo punto di vista su questo? L'ha trovato anche nella Bibbia?
Yahweh è uno dei più grandi assassini della storia.
Okay, Yahweh is one of the biggest murderers or assassins of the history.
I have been saying that ever since I read what he did in the Octrohasis. Thank you, Mauro, for telling the truth, no matter what happens.
Grazie Mauro, per dire la verità, anche Gerald lo sta dicendo da parecchio
tempo.
He's a genocidal
Yahweh faceva uccidere tutti. Allora, lascia stare questa parte qui, ricomincio. Tutti i popoli che Yahweh ha dato ordine di sterminare.
All the people and populations that Yahweh has given order to exterminate.
Erano tutti parenti stretti, cioè zii o nipoti o cugini degli israeliti.
We're all close relatives, so either family, cousins of the Israelites.
Quindi lui li faceva sterminare per prendere i loro territori.
Hence, he would order for them to be exterminated to get their territories.
Questi ordini erano continui.
And these orders were continuous. So he just
se non venivano eseguiti, chi non li eseguiva veniva punito.
And if they weren't followed up the orders that Yahweh was had given, those who objected to these orders would have been severely punished.
Quando Yahweh ha dato ordine di sterminare gli Amalekiti,
when Yahweh gave order to exterminate the Amalekites, did I get the word right?
Il re Saul li ha uccisi tutti.
King Saul killed them all.
Ha lasciato in vita soltanto il loro re.
Leaving only alive their king.
Perché era un maschio bello.
Because he was a handsome looking male.
E Yahweh lo ha punito perché ha lasciato in vita una persona.
And Yahweh punished him because he left one man alive.
E so, gli Amalekiti erano discendenti diretti di Esaù, fratello gemello di Giacobbe.
They were direct descendants of Esau, which was a direct descendant, which was the twin brother of Jacob.
I would ask something real quick, Rex, if I can.
Sure.
Does Mauro see what's going on with Yahweh in the Bible coincident with the actions that were taken in the Atrahasis? Does he connect those two?
Mauro trova una connessione con ciò che succede nell'ultra Atrahasis.
Come
si dice in Atrahasis? And the Bible, did you ask?
In the Atrahasis, Enlil was portrayed as a genocidal murderer. Is he any different? Do you see Enlil as Yahweh, just definitively?
Mauro, lei vede Enlil come Yahweh in quanto è stato anche lui richiesto di...
Io penso, come dicevo prima... Visto che a Yahweh è stata affidata soltanto una famiglia, ho l'impressione che fosse più piccolo di Enlil, poteva essere un figlio.
He thinks he could have been a son, smaller, younger than Enlil, since he was only given a family to take care of.
Perché Enlil era molto potente e Yahweh mi sembra molto meno potente di Enlil.
Sì. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he says because Enlil was very powerful and Yahweh looks less powerful. Definitely less powerful.
Okay.
Go ahead, Rex.
I would like to know about the Nephilim that are discussed in the Bible and the Watchers.
Mauro, Rex chiede, vorrebbe sapere cosa pensa dei Nephilim e dei i Watchers, in italiano
I guardiani, guardiani.
I guardiani, sì.
I guardiani.
I guardiani.
Guardiani,
sì.
Grazie.
Allora, nella Bibbia i guardiani sono i Malachim.
In the Bible, the guardians or the Watchers are the Malachims.
Che sono un grado inferiore degli Elohim nella gerarchia militare.
Which are one step lower in the military hierarchy to the Elohims.
E sono quelli che portavano gli ordini e controllavano.
And they are the ones that were bringing the orders and controlling that the orders were followed.
Per i Nephilim, invece, questi vengono sempre considerati i giganti.
The Nephilims instead of have always been considered the giants.
Che la Bibbia conosce anche con altri nomi, molti altri nomi.
Which in the Bible are known with other names, many other names.
Per i Nefilim in particolare, però, c'è anche un'altra possibile interpretazione.
But for the Nephilims in particular, there could be another possible interpretation.
Okay.
Se si legge il termine Nefilim come derivante da una certa radice di un verbo,
if we interpret the word Nephilim as deriving from a certain root of cosa detto alla fine, scusi?
Radice di un verbo.
The root of a verb.
Potrebbe significare aborti.
It could mean aborted.
E questo poteva avvenire quando gli Elohim si sono uniti con le femmine degli Adam.
Because this could have happened when the Elohim united with the females of the Adam.
E le facevano abortire ogni volta che avevano un feto maschio, facevano nascere solo le femmine.
And they would make these women abort when they knew it was a male fetus, a fetus carrying a male, because they only wanted females.
Quindi questa è un'altra possibile interpretazione di Nephilim.
So, hence, this is another possible interpretation of the Nephilims.
Okay. Però bisogna sapere anche un'altra cosa.
But we also need to know another thing.
In aramaico, la parola Nefilà al singolare indica la costellazione di Orione.
In Aramaic, the word Nefilà as a singular also refers to the constellation of Orion.
Ah, interessante.
E se Nefilim è plurale,
if Nephilim is instead plural,
chissà che non voglia indicare per individui che provenivano di là.
Who knows if it doesn't want to indicate or show that it's for about individuals that were coming from there. So you see the verb and...
Right.
Another thing I'd like to know is...
Can I interject one second?
Great.
Does Mauro want to ask any questions to you? Mauro, lei vorrebbe chiedere, fare delle domande a Gerald?
No, andiamo pure avanti così.
Okay, he says, let's go on like this. It's
awesome.
Okay.
Well, Nibiru is on so many people's minds right now, and you have some direct translations of Nibiru. And it's from these Sumerian tablets. And I would just like all the information you could share with us about Nibiru. You know, if you can give us its orbit or where we can expect it, what kind of cataclysms, if there's going to be any. And I'll stop there.
Thank you. Mauro, allora adesso si parla del... di Nibiru, ciò che è sulla mente di molte persone, e Rex vorrebbe sapere se lei ha forse un'idea di che orbita, quando poter aspettare questo pianeta, se c'è qualche informazione importante al riguardo.
Allora, conosco tutto quello che si dice di Nibiru, so che ci sono molti scienziati che, come dire, lo stanno cercando, ma non ci sono notizie certe, quindi rimaniamo in attesa. La Bibbia non ne parla assolutamente.
Okay, he says yes, he's been following and knows about the story of Nibiru, and that a lot of scientists are looking for it, but there's no certainty about where and when it is. So for the time being, we can just wait and see.
Nelle tavolette sumere di Oxford,
I'd like to add, in the Bible there's no mention of Nibiru, but in the tablets of Oxford.
La tavoletta NBC 11108.
From the table NBC 11008.
C'è scritto che quando gli Anunnaki non erano ancora sulla Terra.
It's written that when the Anunnaki weren't still on Earth,
avevano una casa celeste senza vegetazione.
They had a azure, light blue, sky blue house senza, scusi.
Vegetazione, without vegetables.
Without any vegetation.
Chissà so, che non sia Nibiru.
Who knows if this is not Nibiru, because they were mentioning of them living on a planet that was the color of sky blue.
Interesting.
Now, I'm just wondering if the orbit is the way that it is, and you've heard so many stories about pole shifts, cataclysms, if it's a giant magnet and it pulls all these planets towards it and asteroids, how would the people on Nibiru survive?
Allora, Mauro si domanda se questo pianeta ha una tale potenza che riesce anche a attirare le orbite di altri pianeti, come fanno le persone su Nibiru a sopravvivere?
Beh, allora, diciamo che se sono nate lì, hanno la loro fisiologia e la loro anatomia adatte a quel pianeta. Ovviamente stiamo facendo delle ipotesi perché non ne so nulla e quindi...
Esatto. He says, obviously we're only doing hypothesis because he really doesn't know anything, yeah. But he would imagine that if these people are born on that planet, they would be fit to live under those conditions.
I know he's been at, Mauro's been doing lots of conferences in Italy and elsewhere. What feedback is Mauro getting from his audience? Is he getting any problems from the Vatican?
Allora, Mauro Gerald vorrebbe chiederle in conclusione, sa che lei ha fatto parecchie conferenze in Italia, immagino anche altrove, e vuole sapere che riscontro ha dal pubblico e aggiunge anche se il Vaticano ha messo un po' i bastoni tra le ruote sul suo operato e il suo lavoro.
Allora, parto dalla fine. Io quando ho cominciato a raccontare sono stato immediatamente, diciamo, licenziato come traduttore.
Okay, he's going to start from the last question and he says as soon as he started translating, the way he was translating, he was immediately fired.
Per quanto riguarda il pubblico, diciamo il feedback sta aumentando sempre di più. Difatti per questo anno qui io non ho più date libere e abbiamo chiuso le richieste di conferenze per il 2017.
For what in connection to the feedback he gets, it's ever more growing. This year he has no more space for conference. He's fully booked, and
wow.
It's actually also the same for next year, 2017. He has very little space left.
Congratulations!
Anche perché io devo venire negli Stati Uniti.
Also because Mauro needs to come to the United States.
E io so che devo andare a Parigi, a Lisbona, a Vienna, a Londra.
So, and he also knows that he has to go to Paris, Lisbon, Vienna, and London.
Mm. Nice.
Wow.
Yeah.
You know, and one question also.
Complimenti.
I need to throw in real quick. This is from an avid listener of Leak Project. He wants to know the exact translation of the morning star.
Allora, uno dei delle persone che stanno seguendo con Leak Project vuole sapere l'esatto translation or explanation.
How about both? Yeah, what is the direct translation and what is Mauro's interpretation?
Allora, qual è la diretta traduzione e la sua interpretazione su il Morning Star, che sarebbe la stella del mattino, immagino.
Actually, la stella del mattino è il pianeta Venere.
So the Morning Star is the planet Venus.
Yes.
E nel libro di Isaia, viene citata per paragonarla ad un regnante di Babilonia, ad un re di Babilonia.
And it's mentioned comparing it to a king of Babylon.
Babylon. E a questo re si dice: tu che pensavi di essere come la stella del mattino, sei caduto come tutti gli altri.
And they say, you who thought you were as the morning star, you have fallen like everyone else. Important as the morning star, but you instead, you have fallen down as everyone else.
Hey, Rex, that was a good question. Can I follow up if we're going to do one more?
Yeah, and then I've got one more.
Mauro may be ready to go. So, but what he's bringing up is, I believe there's a correlation between the Anunnaki and the being Lucifer and Satan. And I believe Lucifer is Marduk and Satan is Enlil. And that's what my research shows. So I did an analysis of Isaiah 14:12, and I still believe that he's talking about the son of Venus, who is Marduk, whose offspring became Nebuchadnezzar, that was mentioned in Isaiah 14:12. So that's what I believe.
Mauro è riuscito a seguire, Gerald parlava di Lucifero e personalmente lui crede che Lucifero è Marduk. Lei come la vede? Sì, Marduk.
È possibile fare questa identificazione?
Sì.
Anche perché è importante capire che Lucifero non è il comandante dei diavoli.
Mm-hmm. So it's important to know that Lucifer is not the commander of the devils.
Questa è una invenzione dei teologi.
Sì,
this is
I'm
an agree. Invention of the theologists.
I agree.
E qui, okay, and so I agree too with you.
So you're saying it's an archetype of people, it's not one specific being.
Well, the term Lucifer is a descriptive term. It's not really a name, but many people have tried to adopt that term. And just to further put some fuel on the fire, I believe Marduk and Ninurta are fighting for that title. They both want to be the light bearer for the Enkiites or the Enlilites. That's what I believe. And right now, it looks like Marduk's winning.
Bye, Claudia.
A questo, grazie. A questo proposito, Gerald pensa che Marduk è in competizione con... What was the other figure, please? Can you remind me?
Ninurta Apollo.
Ninurta, okay. O Apollo, che si stanno contendendo il ruolo prima.
Now?
Stanno
sì. Now? Ok. Ok, ma in effetti nelle lotte che si vedono nel mondo è proprio possibile pensare che ci siano loro.
Concordo con lei. Mauro is saying that seeing what's happening, the battles and the wars going on Earth in these times, it could well be that this is happening. And that there is a competition between these two forces of evil, can I put it that way?
E noi siamo il gregge di pecore.
And we are the group of pawns. Sheep, the flock of sheep.
The pawns. Sì. So,
All right, you gotta let me ask one more question. This is okay, we may not have a chance to speak again, so for a while anyway. Mauro, thank you. And my final question is, okay. Revelation, have you translated it, or are you considering the possibility of translating it in the future?
Possibilità di tradurre?
The Revelation, immagino in italiano.
L'Apocalisse,
grazie.
Yeah.
Senza il tuo aiuto non avrei potuto.
Allora, per me dal greco me la sono tradotta più di 10 volte.
Okay, he has for himself from the Greek translated it more than 10 times.
E vedremo in futuro se pubblicare, perché in fondo sono molto giovane, ho solo 66 anni, quindi ho ancora tanto tempo.
And he will decide, and we'll see if in future he will publish this, because he's very young, he's 66, so he still has a lot of time in front of him.
Awesome.
Senz'altro.
Hey.
La ringrazio tanto della cortesia che lei ha avuto.
Grazie a tutti voi. Gerald mi ha scritto il titolo del libro?
Gerald mi ha scritto? Mauro is asking if Gerald, you can Gerald connect with him. Gerald si connetterà con lei per il
libro. Sì, ma mi ha scritto il titolo del libro qui, così lo prendo.
Okay, he wants to know if you, Gerald, have written the title of his book, so he wants to get that book.
Yeah, I'd like to get in touch with you, and I'll provide that to you afterwards.
Allora, Gerald dice che vorrebbe mettersi in comunicazione con lei e darle il libro e dopo questa intervista.
Yeah. Va bene, okay.
Yeah, I okay. Just...
While we're talking, my book is being has been translated to German. It's being translated to French, Romanian, and Chinese at the moment. Okay. So I hope to be in China.
I want to read it in English.
Okay, I'll send it to you. I'll send it to you today, Mauro. Okay. I'll send it to you. Well, I want to really thank Claudia. She volunteered for this. She's in another country, and I won't say where she is, but in a different time zone, both these guys are. So the amount of coordination that's taken, I want to give kudos to Rex and everybody involved for meeting up and sharing. None of us are being paid for this, so thank you. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias.
Como se dice en italiano?
Molte grazie.
Molte grazie. Okay, there you go.
Thank you to you.
Well, hopefully we'll meet again.
Thank you to you all.
Thank you so much, Mauro. It was just an absolute blessing to meet you and speak with you. Claudia, you're an amazing woman. Thank you for this time of yours. And Gerald, you're awesome too, my friend. And I would also just like to say, for those that have listened to this presentation, we'll have a chance to listen to this podcast. It's pretty crazy, isn't it? It's pretty wild to think about the opportunities and how different...
Yes. This is profound. It brings the two pieces together. The Sumerians didn't write myths. Those who derived their documents from the Sumerians wrote the myths. That's my position, and I believe Mauro and I have both come to that same conclusion.
Okay, Claudia, scusa l'ultima parte sui documenti sumeri.
Dice che sia lei che Gerald siete arrivati alla stessa conclusione al riguardo dei documenti sumeri e che quindi speriamo che in futuro si possa continuare a essere in connessione.
Ok.
He says yes, he hopes so too to be in connection.
Okay. Thank you to all.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you to everyone.
The next time.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much, Mauro. Ciao.
Ciao, 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 ciao.
Ciao.
Ciao. Grazie a te, Claudia, per la collaborazione. Sei stata bravissima.
Grazie, lei è stato un angelo ad aiutarmi. Arrivederci. Ciao.
Arrivederci. I like that one.